Good evening, everyone, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you on behalf of the Indian Society for Sleep Research for taking this initiative for this webinar, which is reopening the sleep services in the ongoing pandemic. I don't really need to rationalize the need for this webinar or justify that why are we discussing this. I think all of us in this field have been waiting to come together so that we go through the guidelines which have been published so far and how do we adapt them to our country. So with that, I welcome you again and thank you for being with us and giving us your time. It will be we wanted this to be an actively with participation from everyone. The webinar today has been divided into three major parts. The session one, you will have some talks by the faculty. Session two is a panel discussion with questions which are often asked and again answered by experts. And the session three would be an open-ended question and answer sessions. Thank you again. And now I will hand over to Vatsala. She will coordinate this evening today.
Thank you, Dr. Bhatia. Good evening, everyone. So I'll be introducing the faculty for session one. Dr. Manvi Bhatia, she is a senior neurologist and a sleep specialist at Neurology and Sleep Center. She is also the Vice President of Indian Society for Sleep Research and is the author of the first non-fiction book on sleep, The Sleep Solution. Dr. V. Mohan Kumar formed the Indian Society for Sleep Research and is the founder member of Asian Sleep Research Society. He is currently working as a visiting professor at Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute for Medical Sciences at Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Dr. H.N. Malik is the president of Indian Society for Sleep Research and Asian Sleep Research Society. He has recently retired from AIIMS as a professor in the Department of Physiology. Dr. Deepak Srivastava is a sleep physician in California. He is a professor of medicine, pulmonary and critical care at UC Davis and has always been a support and a pillar to promote sleep education in the country. Dr. Ravi Gupta, he is an additional professor, Division of Sleep Medicine and Department of Psychiatry, AIIMS, Rishikesh. He is the editor-in-chief of the journal Sleep and Vigilance. Now I invite Dr. V. Mohan Kumar to give his talk on Introduction to Sleep Studies during COVID-19.
Good evening. The topic for today's discussion is sleep studies during COVID-19. Coronavirus 2019, or otherwise called COVID-19, was identified in December 2019 in Wuhan, China. India's first case of COVID-19 was reported on 2nd February 2020 from Kerala. On 24th March, Government of India declared a lockdown, and along with that, all non-emergent health services, including sleep studies, came to a grinding halt. India currently has the largest number of confirmed cases of COVID-19 in Asia. On 21st April 2020, American Academy of Sleep Medicine published a revised strategy for reopening sleep clinics and sleep centers. Government of India is the lockdown restrictions on 1st June 2020. Indian Society for Sleep Research came out with a set of guidelines and published it in the International Journal Sleep and Vigilance on 4th July 2020. Not only Indian society, even Saudi Arabian society also came out with a set of guidelines. And I'm not going into the details of it, but essentially I would like to say that they have classified the strategies to be adopted into three. And one, when the community transmission is high, and the second, when the community transmission is moderate, and the third, when the community transmission is either low or minimal. Depending upon the strategies to be adapted, the studies can be either postponed indefinitely or done in a safe manner. And the subsequent speakers will be mainly touching on these topics. Government of India's emphasis on healthcare is poised for a drastic change in the days to come, and emphasis will be primarily on the public health. Progress in technology has fortunately come into our help, and it has revolutionized the way in which the sleep studies can be done in such a pandemic situation. The portable at-home sleep testing devices show a lot of promise. Smartphone apps and wearable tracking devices will become more common in clinical practice in the days to come. Web conferences can always help the doctors and patient interaction. Researchers are going on in finding ways and means to have better study of sleep, which are mostly remain underdiagnosed. ISSR is committed to bring to the doorstep of common man the advancement in sleep technology that are helpful during COVID-19. All said and done, machines can never replace man, and man has to come into the picture at one stage or other.
Now I would like to invite, thank you, Dr. Mohan Kumar. I'd like to invite Dr. Malik to give his talk on the ISSR activities and the ISSR guidelines.
Today I'll be speaking on activities and guidelines by Indian Society for Sleep Research. The first international conference on sleep wakefulness in India was held in New Delhi during September 9-11, 1992. This marked the very beginning of modern sleep medicine in India. The Indian Society for Sleep Research was established during this meeting on 10th September 1992 by the pioneering efforts of Dr. V. Mohan Kumar. Late Professor B. Ramamurthy, the eminent neurosurgeon, was our first president. The purpose of ISSR is exclusively scientific, academic, and literary. The aims and objectives of the society are to foster research on all aspects of sleep and wakefulness, to provide a forum for the exchange of information pertaining to sleep research and sleep medicine, including holding of periodic scientific meetings, to promote education and training in sleep medicine and sleep wakefulness research, to establish and maintain standards of reporting and classifying data in the field of sleep wakefulness and research and sleep medicines, to provide a common forum for interaction between the members working on different aspects of sleep research and sleep medicine. The main activity of the society are organizing national conferences, international conferences, national sleep medicine course, which we are organizing since 2006, national sleep technology course, international sleep specialist certification examination, national sleep technician certification examination, sleep lab accreditation, organizing public awareness program on sleep health and sleep medicine, webinars, and national guidelines on sleep medicine. Our new activities in the recent future will be periodical journal clubs, case presentation on sleep disorder, and techniques in sleep research in order to encourage young postgraduates. Sleep and Vigilance is the official journal of Indian Society for Sleep.
It's 14 hours.
It is being published by Springer Nature. It's a multidisciplinary journal which offers a forum for biomedical and clinical researchers to show and share their work in research articles, case reports, clinical investigations, review articles, and short communications. Besides Sleep and Vigilance, we have some other publications. Important publications like the 25 years of ISSR. And also we have a regular publication like newsletter, which is known as Sleep Watching India. And also we have sleep medicine updates, which is being brought out quarterly. On the right-hand side, you find the faces of our smiling NSMC faculties who are involved in the promotion of sleep medicine in the country for more than 10 years. I salute them. The ISSR brought out a guideline for the practice of sleep medicine during COVID-19. This is published in Sleep and Vigilance. The article is PubMed Index and freely available. I request you to go through this article whenever you have time. I'll not go through the details of the guidelines and the recommendations. I'll just touch upon the summary of findings. Sleep, you all know that sleep services are assigned a non-essential status during COVID-19. The American Academy of Sleep Medicine further strongly urges sleep medicine experts to continue postponing non-urgent care until a later date. However, sleep is important for people's health and well-being. There is a need to reopen the sleep medicine services during the unlock process. The ISSR formed a task force consisting of experts. They examined the documents of various professional organizations and governmental authorities, their applicability in Indian conditions, identification of gaps, if any, and finding out solution by consensus based on evidence. Some of the outcome and recommendation are avoiding doctor-to-patient contact during the pandemic, emphasis of safety for patients and staff, telecommunication is the need of the hour. Patients of most sleep disorders can be provided tele-aftercare service. ISSR guidelines also give a list of medication allowed to be prescribed during the first and the follow-up teleconsultation. COVID-19 patients follow personal protection guidelines as well as social distancing. Details are given in the guidelines. Strategies for the safe conduct of level one sleep studies, as well as home sleep apnea testing. Details are given in the guidelines. Guidelines for PEP therapy during COVID-19 pandemic. The ISSR recommendation is to postpone and reschedule in-laboratory PEP therapy, but it mentions solution for emergency situations. My heartiest congratulations to the ISSR Task Force for bringing out these guidelines. This was done in a very record time. We have distinct guidelines for sleep services to non-COVID and COVID patients. You know that information regarding COVID-19 is still evolving. That may necessitate changes in recommendation from time to time. Thank you all very much for participation in this webinar.
Thank you, Dr. H. N. Malik. Now I invite Dr. Deepak Srivastava to give his talk on current guidelines for reopening the sleep services during the pandemic.
Welcome to the ISSR webinar, Current Guidelines for the Reopening of the Sleep Laboratories During the Pandemic. World Sleep Society has a recent compilation of the reopening of guidelines. Worldwide, the new guidelines have been published. Indian Society for Sleep Research has recently published its guidelines, which is a valuable document. Center for Disease Control in United States is guiding many of these guidelines and should be reviewed. American Academy of Sleep Medicine, in conjunction with the CDC, comes up with the frequently asked questions and updates their guidelines. Australasian Sleep Association, College of Physicians and Surgeons of Alberta, Canada, a collaboration of the French Society for Research and Sleep Medicine, as well as Chinese Sleep Association and Brazilian Sleep Society, amongst others, have issued their guidelines. I have tried to review multiple guidelines and have come up with the common themes that these guidelines are describing. On August 27, AASM has updated their frequently asked questions. The major questions that were updated were: how should decisions be made to restrict, cease, or resume services? How can I determine the local level of community transmission of COVID-19? How should rooms used for patient care be cleaned during the pandemic? And what is an airborne isolation room? We'll address these questions. Current COVID-19 status of the patient, according to the AASM CDC guidelines, are describing as five different categories: recent contact and travel, clinical symptoms and results of the diagnostic testing information should be readily available and asked from the patient. If their status is unknown, if they do not have any symptoms and no known suspected contact with a person who has COVID-19 for at least 14 days, and they do not have a COVID-19 test, their status is considered unknown and high risk. Presumed negative, patients do not have any symptoms and there is no known or suspected contact with a person who has COVID-19 for at least 14 days. Negative COVID-19 test with low clinical suspicion. Interpret these results with caution as pre-symptomatic transmission and asymptomatic transmission have been reported. These patients are presumed negative. Third is self-quarantine group. The patients who have been staying home and self-monitoring for 14 days after recently having a close contact with a person with COVID-19. recently traveling from somewhere outside the United States or on a cruise ship or river boat where the risk of confinement and infection is high. Presumed positive, these are the symptomatic patients who have, for example, fever, cough, shortness of breath, or other symptoms like loss of taste and smelling, or abdominal pain, diarrhea, and or positive or have pending COVID-19 test without the availability of the results. And then the last group is presumed recovered, people who do not have fever for at least 72 hours without the use of fever reducing medications, other symptoms that have improved, and at least 7 days since the symptoms first appeared, or they do not have any fever without the use of fever reducing medication or other symptoms have improved with two negative tests in a row at least 24 hours apart. Well, this condition is difficult to meet because in order to get these two tests 24 hours apart is not an easy option. So these are the current COVID status of the patient described in five categories. Then we look at the screening of the patient before they come to the lab. The screening of the patient is divided into two, prior to their in-person appointment screening, as well as once they arrive, and again at the time of the appointment before entering the facility. The pre-screening prior to appointment testing can be done with the phone calls, patient portals, or online self-assessment tools. Review the COVID-19 symptoms such as fever, cough, shortness of breath, and other symptoms that were earlier alluded to. Review the COVID-19 status as described in five categories previously, and reschedule the patient with symptoms or positive or pending COVID-19 test. These are the high-risk symptoms. The screening of the patient at the time of the appointment. As the patient arrives to the facility, check the temperature and screen the patient again for the COVID-19 symptoms, again including fever, shortness of breath, cough, and other symptoms as described, and testing status upon their arrival at the facility. Any patients who have symptoms or positive or pending COVID-19 test, that is, the results are not available, please reschedule those patients. Refer these patients for diagnostic testing or clinical care as appropriate for a future evaluation. The staff has the equal importance in the screening. The screening of the staff should be done, including all the healthcare personnel as well as office staff must be routinely screened for COVID-19 symptoms, as we discussed, and should take temperature checks two times every day and should be reported to the supervisor. Send the staff members home if they are symptomatic. Adopt a very flexible and or reduced scheduling to account for staff needing to be off during the illness or the quarantine. So a policy should be user-friendly and staff should be supported if they are sick. Other staff should be available to cover the rest breaks if working with reduced level of staffing. So there should be rest periods for the staff, either by way of frequent breaks or by way of additional personnel. Community transmission is considered in four categories. The substantial transmission is considered that when the healthcare staffing is significantly impacted because of the high level of community transmission and there are multiple cases within the communal settings. If testing for COVID-19 infection is available and feasible, all patients should be tested in a reasonable time frame before coming to the sleep center, in addition to being screened for the symptoms. If they are positive or results are not available, postpone and reschedule in-lab administration of PAP therapy, PAP titration studies, or split night studies, except in emergency situation. In the emergency situation, review the potential for aerosolization. Ensure that the appropriate personal protective equipment is available. And PAP administration can be done in an airborne infection isolation room, AIRR, which is a negative pressure room. By definition, that there are six air exchanges take place every hour according to the CDC transmission-based precautions. Avoid operating positive airway pressure in the clinic settings due to the risk of aerosolization. Postpone and reschedule polysomnography for children and adults except in emergencies. And in United States, insurance companies pay for PAP device, just a diagnosis of sleep apnea made based on the clinical assessment, and no PSG or home sleep test is required. There are validated screening and assessment tools. Specific criteria to justify the prescription of CPAP devices are unavailable. Also, there are no guidelines what should be done after the pandemic goes away to these patients who have received the clinical diagnosis and PAP device based on the clinical diagnosis. Those guidelines will be coming out sometime soon. That's what my belief is. The substantial transmission also dictates restricted use of home sleep testing according to the following parameters. Postpone and reschedule all non-emergency in-person appointments. Conduct all the visits by telemedicine. The telemedicine coverage should be expanded. In this table here, I have the benchmarks, minimal, moderate, and substantial, how we differentiate how many cases. So over 100 cases per 100,000 population will make it substantial. 10 to 100 cases per 100,000 population makes it moderate transmission, and 10 cases per 100,000 make a minimum transmission. The percent positivity also qualifies it. More than 10% positive cases is substantial, 5 to 10% is moderate, and less than 5% is minimal. COVID-like illness in more than 10% is considered substantial transmission, 5 to 10% is moderate, and less than 5% is minimal. This is from the Arizona State Department guidelines. Minimal to moderate community transmission is considered multiple cases of COVID-19, as we noticed, 10 to 100 cases per 100,000 population in the community. In that situation, postpone and reschedule in-lab administration of PAP therapy unless testing takes place in the NAIRR, as we discussed earlier, except in the emergency situation, and avoid the CPAP use in the clinic settings. Postpone all PSGs in older adults because they are at high risk, pregnancy at high risk, and people of any age who might be at high risk for severe illness from COVID-19. This table is the same that we have reviewed. Community transmission, if it is minimal to moderate, consider resuming diagnostic PSG for children and adults who are not at high risk for severe illness from COVID-19. Resume in-person clinic appointments for children and adults who are not at high risk for severe illness from COVID-19. And if telemedicine visits are not available or inadequate, then only bring these patients into the clinic. Again, the table has the same guidelines. If the community transmission is minimal to moderate, restrict the home sleep test services according to the previously described parameter. Additional options of using curbside pickup and return instead of delivery services model. Visitors should be limited to the sleep lab or even to pick up the home sleep testing machine if necessary for an aspect of the patient care they are allowed, and pre-screen these visitors same way as the patients will be screened. If the community transmission is lowest, none or minimal, resume in-lab administration of the CPAP, BiPAP therapy, and PAP use in the clinic setting. Resume diagnostic PSG for all children and adults for whom testing is indicated, and resume in-person appointments as needed, including clinic visits and PAP setups. Resume normal operations. I hope that this information will come in handy and useful when you will look at your own practice and decide whether you are ready for resuming the operation and reopening your sleep practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak Srivastava. Now I invite Dr. Manvi Bhatia to give her talk on adapting guidelines in practice in India for level 1.
Good evening, everyone. Today I shall be discussing the topic adapting the guidelines for restarting sleep services in this presence of the ongoing pandemic in India. We have heard in the previous talks the American Academy of Sleep Medicine guidelines and what are their recommendations. So we thought that we would go over this. How can we adapt this into our country? So what we have learned so far, the two most important things which determine how to open or reopen this are, first, the current status in the environment of the COVID pandemic situation. And this has been divided into three categories, substantial, minimum to moderate, or none. And this is depending upon the number of cases in the vicinity in that time. The second is the status of the patient. And those are either it is COVID positive or COVID negative, and further categories such as COVID presumed positive or COVID presumed negative, depending if the tests have been done or not. But we all do agree about the dynamic nature of this pandemic, and which requires a continuous reappraisals and re-strategies so that we can work on this together. The few facts that we do know about this is that at the beginning or the onset of this pandemic, certain services were considered essential and non-essential. And where does sleep medicine really fit? Is this an essential service or is it a non-essential? And with the passage of time, I think we do need to relook, reopen, so that we can help the patients who have these issues. We also know and agree that all kinds of sleep disorders, those which are predominantly the obstructive sleep apnea and the insomnia, they play a major role in the body's defense mechanisms or immunity against the COVID. So we definitely need to improve sleep. And it's also known that patients who have obstructive sleep apnea are at a greater risk for developing complications if they develop COVID. It's also been seen that there is an underutilization of the healthcare in this non-COVID patients, and which has been reported in numerous journals and articles, even up to the extent that the cardiac cases have also been affected, and people do not want to go in for admissions for this condition. So thus, we need to provide services and need to continue to provide services while minimizing the risk to the patient and the healthcare personnel. So this is where the status in India is, that we are still seeing a rise in the number of new cases and thus still need to have a word about caution. So India is a big country and we have different states. This data shows that some states, though overall India's graph is up, but some states have reached a peak and are on their way down, and some maybe have come down to the lower part of the curve, and that is Delhi. So I guess we do need to understand where we are, and even though we are talking about India, we need to reevaluate and relook at the state or area that we are placed in. But to go further, the level one study for the three of the four major areas that one should keep in mind, or what are the things that one can consider being important. First and foremost is the patient safety, the technician safety. What can we do to make the facility more safer, and what can we do about the equipment? So I think these are the four major things. But yes, we need to continue to provide the telehealth services, which have been a very big boon in the coming time, especially for patients with insomnia and those who are just follow-up patients. We can easily do an online consult. But yes, with the passage of time and as the pandemic situation gets better, you could do what is called as a hybrid model, that is some online and some physical or what physical presence. Of course, but the rules would apply, that we screen everyone who comes in, make sure that a physical distance is maintained and adequate cover is protected. The healthcare provider should also ensure that they take all the precautions required when they are seeing patients in a physical or a face-to-face scenario. And in addition, the responsibility of ensuring that the facility, whether it is a center, the clinic, the hospital, all should have the systems in place for routine cleaning and disinfection. Then comes the second major stakeholder, and that's the patient. So the patients, the major question which arises is when to get the COVID-19 testing. And some of this data I have collected from the articles which have been published recently. Number one being the risk. So is this a titration study which carries a higher risk than a pure diagnostic study? The availability and the local transmission rates will be also governing factors as to when to get this COVID-19 testing. The policy for handling a positive case should be in place. And if the patient is a positive case who's called you up, then ideally should have a COVID negative test. In fact, some people were asking for two COVID negative tests. So is two required? Is one enough? I think is what we need to still be determined. Those with comorbidities versus no comorbidities are at a higher risk, so should be considered for a COVID-19 testing. And those who had a history of contact with COVID positive should have a testing. And of course, if they have symptoms. So in this or in these few conditions, it is required that before one does a lab one study or a lab or a level one study, we should get the COVID-19 testing done. What about the recommendations for the personnel? Continuous education is required. You know, sometimes we assume that the technicians or the ancillary staff, the center staff understand and are aware of what the precautions, but it's our responsibility to educate them. There should be screening protocols, not only for the patients, but also for the staff in place. And some are doing morning, evening screening. Selection and use of the PPE for the personal protective equipment, what is required, the gowns, the masks, the gloves, how often to change them, the sanitizers, physical distancing, not only between the patient and the staff, but also amongst the staff, frequent hand washing, the staff to patients ratio. This is also particularly important for the level one study. Earlier, it was recommended that one technician could manage two patients, but I think with this time, maybe one to one. The availability of the protective is really to be considered. So there should be enough stock and provision. Everybody should know where they are placed, all things like the gowns, the masks, etc. The other responsibility becomes for the technician. Now more than ever, ensure that they get adequate rest, recovery time, and if they have any respiratory symptoms, to report and not to come for work and to be granted sick leave. The third aspect that we need to consider for the level one studies is the facility. And that includes, again, just to reinforce the social distancing, the decreased in-person visits, avoid overcrowding, and the availability of the PPE stuff, and to educate and maintain a good air quality, ensure ventilation, and make sure that the room is clean and disinfect a room between each studies. The other fourth dimension is the equipment. There will be a short video which will show, but basically the equipment's divided into the diagnostic equipments, which could be the equipments for the level one study or the level three study, along with the sensors, along with all the any wires, etc., that are used, and for the therapy devices, the masks, the filters, the tubes, how should they be taken care of and how should they be disinfected and between each patient's use. These are the two articles which had come in this issue, the current issue of the journal Sleep and Vigilance, One is by the Indian Society for Sleep Research, where numerous authors came together and gave some guidelines for practicing of sleep medicine during the COVID-19. And another article is in the same journal about reopening the sleep medicine services. So I have taken some content of my talk from these two articles. But there has been a recent, again, in the American Academy of Sleep Medicine website, they have summarized the CDC recommendations relevant for the sleep practices during this COVID, and particularly emphasis on the aerosol generating procedures, because we do know that these procedures have a higher chance of infections, particularly, and these are from suctions to endotracheal intubation. But regarding or with reference to the sleep, it is the bilevel devices and the CPAP devices. They've also talked about the inpatient PAP use for patients with suspected or confirmed COVID-19, and have said that this may increase the aerosolization, therefore the potential transmission of virus, and this should be avoided as much as possible, and especially in the absence of proper ventilation or access to PPE. So one does have to take into consideration your own benefit or risk ratio and then decide, but these are high risk conditions. What about those with COVID negative? They mentioned three major things which should be determining this scenario, and that is the background prevalence, how necessary is the PAP, and how can one protect the healthcare professionals. So if these factors are considered, one can consider PAP devices for the COVID negative patients. To go over whatever I have said, we made a simple flow chart. Number one is the endemicity of the COVID-19 in the area that you are in. And second major aspect is the patient's COVID status. Estimate the risk benefit ratio, and then divide them into three categories: the high risk, the low risk, or the no risk. And no risk is the ideal situation. High risk, yes, postpone or reschedule the level one studies. For low risk, consider an opening to the diagnostic PSGs, and no risk, you can do the PSG plus PAP. What to do with patients who are severe and yet in the high risk is what we will discuss in our panel discussions and the question and answer sessions to make this more clear. Of course, these people, if they can wait, then one should reschedule and recheck later. The current scenario in India right now, we have about 8 lakhs people as active cases, and about 29 lakhs which have recovered. So it's still a very high number. This is the map which shows currently the status. The yellow green showing very low areas, and the ones with the orange and red showing high populated or densely populated areas with the COVID-19. To summarize, sleep services, should they be now thought of as essential versus non-essential, or especially in, let's say, some category of patients? From our perspective, we need to stay in touch with the day-to-day local situation. You may not need to watch too much news, but you do need to stay in touch to know what's happening in your area, are you in a containment zone, and the number of active cases being determined. Modify the policies as we go along, and maybe we will have another webinar in the years times to come, in the few months to come, that when we could all function as what we were before. But of course, exercise caution and follow complete infection control guidelines as have been recommended. Thank you so much for your attention and being with us today.
Thank you, Dr. Manveer Bhatia. Now I will invite Dr. Ravi Gupta to give his talk on adapting guidelines in practice in India for HST.
Good evening, dear friends. I would like to convey my sincere thanks to Indian Society for Sleep Research for providing me this opportunity to share my thoughts regarding home sleep apnea testing during COVID-19 pandemic. So In this presentation, we will discuss about the guidelines regarding the home sleep apnea testing during non-COVID period. Then we will see how these guidelines be modified during the COVID period. And then finally, I'll summarize the whole presentation. So yesterday, when we were thinking about the format of this webinar, Dr. H.N. Malik, whom we can see on the top here in this group of photographs, you can he asked us a question. Is sleep study an emergency? And all of us were taken aback. The senior members, Manveer ma'am, Deepak sir, Mohan Kumar sir, even they had to think before answering it. And then finally we realized, yes, sleep study can be an emergency in certain situations, especially when the sleep symptoms, they become disabling, when they are bringing the major limitations in the personal, social, and occupational functioning, when these symptoms can lead to medico-legal issues because of the threat to the life of the person himself or the other people. So we all see the cases of the parasomnia overlap and the sleep-related seizures where the patient, they make complex movement and they can harm other people. Then the patients with hypersomnia, insomnia, and sleep apnea, because they are having excessive sleepiness and many of them, they are having cognitive dysfunction. So they can be indulged into the activities which can be harming to the others. So yes, in these cases, sleep study can be an emergency procedure. If you look at the indications for the home sleep apnea testing, according to the American Academy of Sleep Medicine, it clearly mentions that home sleep apnea testing is limited to the patients who are having OSA, but without other complications like alveolar hypoventilation, neuromuscular problems, the central sleep apnea, cerebrovascular problems, and so on. One of the major problem is that the home sleep apnea testing is having high chances of false negative results. So if you are dealing with a patient who is having high pretest probability of having sleep apnea and the HSET tests are negative, then you have to take the patient into the in-lab testing. On the other hand, some data suggest that when the groups undergoing HSET were compared with the groups undergoing the in-lab attended diagnosis and titration studies, so these groups do not differ with regards to the excessive daytime sleepiness, quality of life, and adherence to the CPAP. That means home sleep apnea testing are effective provided we choose the case carefully. Now, when you are doing the home sleep apnea testing for the diagnosis, for the follow-up, and if there is a case of having confirmed OSA, then you have two choices. Either you prescribe the AutoPAP or you call the patient for the in-lab titration. Now, what does these guidelines mean? These guidelines mean that a group of patients which are having the sleep study as an emergency, only they can be offered some help. But one of the major issues is when you look at this, these guidelines, they mention that the home sleep apnea testing device means the device is having only the cardiorespiratory parameters. But nowadays we have certain devices which are having the EEG or EKG or EMG parameters along with the cardiorespiratory signals. So whether these devices can be used to provide some relief to the patients which are mentioned in the red color font on this slide. Well, of course, as of now, we don't have any data available for the use of these devices where the HSET is contraindicated. Now, one of the major issue is, should we attempt such thing? If we attempt such thing, then probably we are trying to provide at least some benefit to the patient. Now this has to be compared with the situation where we are not offering any help to the patient. So theoretically speaking, at least some help is better than nothing. If we look at the different societies' guidelines regarding the use of home sleep apnea testing during COVID-19, you can see that most of the societies, they mention that the home sleep apnea testing is preferred over the in-lab testing so as to prevent the infection. And most of the guidelines, they also mention that instead of the CPAP and the in-lab titration, AutoPAP should be started and should be started at home. But at the same time, these guidelines mention that rental devices, that means the sharing of the devices at home, should not be done. That means you provide the AutoPAP to the patient only when he is ready to purchase it. Then some of these guidelines mention that non-wanted masks can be better than the mask that we use regularly. So these most of the societies you can see here, they are having almost a unanimity that the home sleep apnea testing should be done, especially in the present circumstances, for the patients with the non-complicated OSA. Now, Indian guidelines, which were published last month, they also go with the previous guidelines, and they mention that the home sleep apnea testing should be done in the non-complicated patients with the OSA. But the only issue is how to prevent the transmission of infection between the patients and between the sleep tech and the patients. So to prevent that, these guidelines mention ways to sterilize the equipments before you use them again or before you bring them to your own laboratory. Now, whether AutoPAP can be given or not, that's again a big question. So the latest parameters that are available with us are from the American Academy of Sleep Medicine, and this paper was published in 2008. So it clearly mentions that AutoPAP cannot be used for the diagnosis of OSA, cannot be used in the cases of complicated OSA, but yes, in non-complicated cases of OSA, it can be used as a first-line therapy after a diagnostic sleep study without in-lab titration as an option. Of course, when you are seeing such patients and you are using the AutoPAP, the patient should be monitored closely for their excessive daytime sleepiness and other clinical parameters, and accordingly, the pressure either has to be adjusted then and there, or you call the patient for the in-lab titration. Now, certain papers, they mention that APAP can be used without the diagnostic polysomnography. And one of these papers was published in Annals of Internal Medicine in 2007. And this paper suggests that using the APAP directly on the patients with OSA, and when they are compared with a group of patients who underwent the in-lab polysomnography along with the in-lab PAP titration, after 3 months, both the groups were equal in terms of the compliance to the CPAP, the pressure of the CPAP, the excessive daytime sleepiness, and the quality of life. Now, another paper which was published recently in the Indian Journal of Respiratory Care, it clearly mentions that unattended APAP can lead to optimal and good titration in 90% of the patient. So there is a possibility that APAP can be used in the patients who are where it is not contraindicated according to the guidelines, and we can provide some help. So in summary, the code-rated home sleep apnea testing guidelines, they mainly focus on the OSA, especially the uncomplicated OSA. They preferred home sleep apnea testing over the attended PSG, and they prefer the use of AutoPAP. But the limitations of the home sleep apnea testing should be considered before you start this procedure. Now, there are certain unresolved issues. First, how to ensure the prevention of transmission of infection between the patient and the sleep tech at an affordable cost. Second, what is the role of these headset devices which are having the extended channels? Then, can APAP be used as diagnostic as well as titrating device? And how to offer services to the patient with the complicated OSA and other sleep disorder? So as of now, we don't have any guidelines regarding these issues. So you are free to have your own opinion based on your own clinical experience. And probably, maybe after this session, we will be having a panel discussion. So there probably we can get some idea about what to do. With this, I end my presentation. Thank you very much once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Gupta. As we are closing the session one, we will close this session with a short clip on disinfection of sleep equipment by Nidhi Bisht, who is a sleep coach.
Today, I'm going to demonstrate cleaning or disinfection of sleep equipment used in polysomnography. So we have diagnostic and therapy devices. First, we will start with diagnostic devices. In this, we have Alice 5, Alice PDX and Alice Night 1. Right now, we are having Alice PDX. So in this, either we can use mild detergent or 70% isopropyl alcohol solution. So you have to take a little bit of isopropyl alcohol solution on your clothes and you have to gently wipe your device. So you have to disinfect your device in between every patient you will use this device. So in same manner, you have to disinfect your Alice 5 and Alice Night 1. So after a diagnostic device, right now we have EEG and ECG aux, effort belt, sensors and pulse oximeter. So we have to wipe them with a mild detergent or soapy solution. Please do not use alcohol based cleanser for cleaning of these accessories. So after diagnostic device, right now we have a therapy device, Dream Station. So before cleaning, you have to unplug the device and you have to remove the pollen filter and gently wipe the whole device with the mild detergent solution or 70% isopropyl alcohol solution. And you have to remove this humidifier portion and you have to wash the water chamber with mild detergent solution. So after therapy device, we have therapy accessories. First one is your mask and second is tube. So before you start cleaning of mask, you have to remove this headgear, otherwise it will get damaged. And you have to immerse both mask and tube in a solution of mild detergent and soapy water for half an hour. After that, clean with fresh water and allow them to air dry.
Thank you everyone for the session one. We are now proceeding with session two, that is the panel discussion. And I will be introducing and inviting Dr. Preeti Devnani as she will be moderating and introducing the panelists.
Thank you everyone. I thank the ISSR for putting together this very important webinar in our unprecedented times. To help us in this panel, we have three esteemed colleagues who are joining us today. We have Dr. Suresh Kumar, Dr. Saurabh Das, and Dr. Abhishek Goyal. Just briefly introducing them. Dr. Suresh Kumar is a MD, DM Neuro from AIIMS. He is well established in the sleep community in India and internationally. He is a fellow epilepsy from UCLA and also is a sleep ISDA fellow. He's a consultant neurologist at Fortis Malar, Chennai, head of Department of Neurology at Sri Balaji Medical College and Hospital Crumpet, and the director of Chennai Epilepsy and Sleep Disorders Center. Our second panelist today is Dr. Saurabh Das. He is playing a very vital role in the growth of Indian sleep community. He's a consultant psychiatrist, sleep medicine specialist. He's a consultant at Medica Super Speciality Hospital, Calcutta, and the director of the Somnus Sleep Clinic in Calcutta. Our third panelist today is Dr. Abhishek Goyal. He's an associate professor of pulmonary medicine at AIIMS Bhopal, and he's trained in sleep medicine at PGI Chandigarh and Cleveland Clinic USA. So I thank the panelists and welcome them on board. So our first question today is directed to Dr. Suresh Kumar. Dr. Kumar, if we have a person who presents with a possible clinical diagnosis of narcolepsy, and he has been advised to get a sleep study and MSLT, could you please assist further, and how would you discuss this with the patient? Dr. Suresh?
Suresh, you have to answer.
I think Dr. Suresh is still on mute. Okay, I have since.
Yep. Yeah, hello. Can you hear me now?
Yes, go ahead, Dr. Suresh. We can hear you.
Yeah. So I think this current COVID situation in terms of evaluating patients with narcolepsy, we just need to understand that getting an MSLT done would not be a major issue, because it's more of a daytime study and it can be easily performed with the current guidelines, which we usually perform the MSLTs. But when it comes to an overnight polysomnography before making a diagnosis of narcolepsy, it would be a bit of a problem when if we need to look at how comfortable the patient is in staying in a room and going ahead with the study. And the same goes with the MSLT as well, because he has to stay in the room for over a period of at least 12 to 24 hours. So in that situation, what I would probably do is that we would be going through a standard protocol of pre-study fumigation of the room, so that giving a 24-hour break and then going ahead with the test. Of course, we would definitely keep all the other parameters, safety parameters in terms of cleansing of equipment and all those things, be ready. Luckily, in narcolepsy, and it's going to be a diagnostic sleep study, we won't be requiring any of the devices to connect to a PAP device or any tubings to be done. So in that way, it seems to be more safer in terms of testing these patients for narcolepsy. We do find that this should not be a major issue, because most of the patients with narcolepsy are young people, and with young people, the incidence of developing COVID is much, much, much lesser as compared to those in elderly people whom we rarely encounter in terms of narcolepsy as such, though we do a polysomnography in those patients. So that's what is my take, that, you know, I think we can safely go ahead with a MSLT in these patients, as it's a study which is quite safe, and we can definitely keep the room sanitization well done before the study, and we can go ahead. And since if the air conditioner is something which is very good, and it's got a negative pressure ventilation which is there in the sleep study room, that will be all the more better. But of course, since these machines are all portable, we can always take it up to our isolation rooms and get the study done there also, if it is a necessity to be done there. That's what I'd like to say.
Okay. So at this point, if it's an elective test, you are suggesting that you can re-stratify in the community if the patient is comfortable, then going ahead with the procedure of the polysomnogram and MSLT can be done, taking all the necessary cautions that we've discussed.
Yes, definitely, yes.
And if the patient is hesitant yet, which we do see some patients, would empiric treatment be something you might discuss?
I didn't quite get your question. Empiric treatment?
For the hypersomnia, if the patient is unagreeable to come in for the sleep test at this time?
Yeah.
Then would you symptomatically manage their symptoms to tide over this period? Or?
Yes, definitely. I mean, like, if it is if the primary symptomatology is excessive daytime sleepiness and we need to add some medications to help him out with that situation, definitely we would like to give a medical therapy. And once the COVID situation is better and the patient is more comfortable in coming in for a test, we can always go ahead with the testing.
I think that's a very important point Dr. Suresh Kumar is saying, to keep the dialogue between the physician and patient open at all times. If you feel it's appropriate enough, we can go ahead taking all the necessary precautions and have a open discussion with your patient. So that's a very important point, Dr. Suresh. Would you like to add anything else, or we can move on to the next question?
I think we can move on to the next question.
Okay, this is to Dr. Saurabh Das. So Dr. Saurabh, we have a regular CPAP user. Should I continue to use CPAP during this time? And is there any specific precautions for cleaning and changing the mask tubing that I should be aware about?
Thank you, Priti ma'am, for describing the question to me. I would like to take it in a way that first I will have to decide whether the person who is this regular CPAP user, we have to decide on two things. The first thing is whether the person is having COVID-19 positive, or the person or at high risk of COVID-19 positive, or whether the person is himself or herself COVID-19 negative and in a setup where there is low risk of transmission. That is one area we need to look at. The other area should be the severity of OSA for which the person is using CPAP, like whether the person is having a mild to moderate OSA or a very severe OSA along with comorbidities. So if we try to look at this question in these parts, I think we can take it in a more simple way. First, I would like to answer in terms of a patient who is not having COVID positive, himself is not COVID positive, or there is no as such contact of COVID in his household, and the person is having a moderate to severe OSA, I think the person should use the CPAP as usual. However, regarding the cleaning and changing the mask and tubes, that has to be done a bit more frequently. Ideally, every manufacturer recommends certain amount of time should pass before the cleaning is done. And usually it is around every one to two days, you're supposed to clean your mask and your tubes and everything. But in the practical scenario, we rarely see that patients are doing that. They usually clean it once a week or once every 2 weeks. And some patients only clean it when they like look dirty like that. So in this current scenario, I would recommend that the people should clean their masks a bit more frequently, even if they are not COVID positive or in a COVID positive environment. Now coming to those patients who are actually having a risk of COVID, having a high risk of COVID along with a low risk of OSA, the person has to discuss with their treating physician regarding the need of using CPAP or rather stratification of the need versus risk of not using the CPAP on his current medical scenario. Now, if the person is having a very mild CPAP with not much comorbidities and the person is COVID positive, I would recommend the person to follow other non-CPAP methods of treatment. For example, the person should be advised to follow positional therapy. The person should be advised to have other aspects of treatment so that the person can stay without using CPAP for some time while this COVID thing passes away in his own household. On the other hand, if the person is having a severe or moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea and the person needs to use CPAP, then in that case, the person should follow certain set of precautions. First and foremost should be a total isolation of that person in one particular room of the house, preferably with attached bathroom and access to a separate kitchen. Secondly, the person should try to put the CPAP on a auto on, auto off mode, so that sometimes what happens is that person wakes up and gets to the washroom at the middle of the night and the CPAP keeps on running. That increases the aerosolization, so that if the device is kept on auto off, auto on mode, then in that case the risk can be decreased. Thirdly, I would recommend there are studies which shows that the type of mask that is used, for example, a nasal mask or a nasal prongs or the nasal type of mask, they have a higher risk of aerosolization compared to a full oro nasal mask. So it should be recommended that in those times the patient should try to use a oro nasal mask if they are comfortable with that. And also another very important part is that if there is availability of non-vented mask, that should also be recommended. also whether if when the person wakes up in the morning, the person should check and if there is mucus or saliva, etc. in the mask, that should be regularly cleaned routinely, and the cleaning agent should preferably be some mild detergent or soapy water, and air dried after that, as was mentioned previously in the in another talk. And also 70% isopropyl alcohol is a good agent of choice to clean those devices like masks and tubes, etc. However, I should mention here that certain sanitization agents like ammonium, like quaternary ammonium compounds, or there are some other things like which are chlorinating agents, they should be avoided completely because they are irritant to the human respiratory tract, and if the mask or tubes are cleaned with those things, then it can cause certain problems and irritation of the upper respiratory tract. Also, another important point is that regarding the use of humidifier, it has been seen that there has been some evidence which says that using a humidifier actually increases aerosolization. So if it is possible and in discussion with the treating physician, humidifier use could be limited during this particular period of time. So I would like to finish my talk here.
Well, thank you, Dr. Saurav. That was a very excellent compilation. So just to recap, Dr. Saurav mentioned in very different scenarios, whether we were dealing, first of all, with a mild or moderate severe case of obstructive sleep apnea. He talked to us about the different conditions, whether the patient was in a COVID positive, whether he has access to patients in the household who have COVID exposure. He also talked to us of the different masks that we should consider when we are treating these patients. The different agents and the importance and the need for sterilization is reinforced. And also the rule, the thought process of the humidifier increasing aerosolization to prevent the spread of COVID. So thank you, Dr. Saurav. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, I think that is enough, ma'am.
All right, so we'll move on then to the next question. And we have our final panelist here, Dr. Abhishek Goyal. Dr. Abhishek, we'd like to ask you the way you clinically would like to approach this case. We have a patient here who has the following findings on home sleep test. We have an AHI of 50 per hour, ODI of 40. The lowest oxygen saturation reached was 70%, and patient was below 90% of oxygen for almost 60 minutes during the procedure. So what device do you think should be advised for this patient if they're considering a PAP trial to be done at home?
Thank you, Dr. Preeti, for this case. Can you tell me more about this case? What is the age and BMI of this patient?
So I think the BMI was 40 and the individual is 65 years old.
Okay. So in our sleep clinic, we analyze our data of around 400 patients who underwent level 1 PSG and underwent manual titration. And we try to find out what can we make some factors which can predict whether the patient is going to use, whether the patient is going to require BiPAP or CPAP. So we found five factors on the basis of five binary cutoff of five factors was made. One was age, if age is more than 60, and if BMI is more than 35, and if AHI was more than 75, and if T90, the time spent below 90%, was more than 30% of the total sleep duration. If these factors were there, along with FEV1 on PFT, then we found that if these factors are positive, then chances of patients requiring BiPAP, that is patients failing CPAP titration, was significantly high. So as you said, this patient had a BMI of 40 and age was 65. Then in this subset, probably CPAP will fail. So I would like to go for a BiPAP board for at home. And if this patient would have been a thinner patient and a younger patient, then I would have gone for the CPAP mode at home.
So I just, Dr. Abhishek, thank you so much for eluding to the points that you take into consideration when doing thinking if the patient is going to settle on a CPAP or a BiPAP. And I think the second case that we had to discuss is also, if you could just run over quite briefly, because we are running short of time. And I think you already pointed out to the importance of BMI The total sleep time here in this case below 90% was less than 5% of the total sleep study.
Okay. So the sleep study has already been done in this patient, I suppose?
Yes.
Okay, then for this patient, BMI of 40 and age of 58 straight away, I will go for a BiPAP titration. I will go for a higher IPAP and EPAP pressures, because with this kind of BMI, we have seen that patient requires very high pressures. So I will go for IPAP of not less than 24 and EPAP of not less than 16. And I would go for this pressure, and I will call the patient, or I will not call the patient in this current scenario. So I will ask the patient to send me the download data. And after 2 weeks, if patient is not improving, symptoms are not improving, and AHI is still high, then I will further increase the pressure by 2 centimeters, and then I will see the patient. And I would also like the patient to go for a lateral position during this BiPAP mode, because we have seen that some patients do not settle in supine mode, who is very obese.
All right. So Dr. Abhishek mentioned to us that when he's discussing cases, it's important to get into a point, the age of the patient, the BMI, the oxygen saturation, and the apnea-hypopnea index. Thank you, Dr. Abhishek. With this, I'd like to hand over again to Dr. Vatsala.
Thank you, Dr. Preeti, and to other panelists. We are now moving on session 3, that is the question and answer session. And I'll be inviting Dr. Deepak Srivastava to moderate this session.
All right, thank you everyone. That was a very interesting conversation, especially during the case reviews and panel discussion. And of course, the speakers were well prepared, and we had shared a lot of information. So this is the time now for the test. And I will invite all the faculty and the panelists to answer some of the questions that have been submitted by the audience. So some questions were submitted by Google in the Google Forms, and others came during the chat and the question answer while you were discussing the cases or and the topics. So let's start with the first question. And I'll target this question to people who have some experience and research in this area, which will be psychiatry and neurology. So starting with the panelists there, the lead panelist, the moderator, Dr. Devnani, and Dr. Ravi Gupta, and others. What is the incidence of insomnia in COVID-19 pandemic? And I would like to hear your comments and how to manage it and how to prevent it.
Dr. Ravi, do you want to go first or?
Dr. Ravi, please go first.
I think he's on mute, yeah, okay.
Okay, you go ahead, Dr. Ravi.
Yeah, so I think that there's a very valid point that the first question said, it sums us all. We all get asked by patients, are we more at risk of developing COVID? That's sleep apnea. And what is going to be the predicted outcome if we are subject to, getting infected in this COVID pandemic? So we kind of have a better handle on the second part of this question, where we know that patients who have OSA and other comorbidities can have a worse outcome in patients who, compared to people who are not having any comorbidities, if they do have infection with COVID. There are many factors that go with it. There's associated obesity, there's associated cardiac involvements that can be associated, and also this increased risk of the cytokine storm. But having said that, are we more exposed to getting COVID just because we have sleep apnea and prevalence? I don't think we have enough data to suggest that. With that, I can hand over to Dr. Ravi.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir, I think the question was related, one part of the question was related to insomnia incidence as well.
Yes.
So as of the incidence of the insomnia is considered in the patients with the COVID, we don't have any data so far. When we talk about the incidence of insomnia in the COVID era, I mean this time, even the general population, we don't have any data. But yes, regarding the prevalence of insomnia, if we talk about, so there are two studies which are to my notice. One of the studies we did in India itself. And here we found that the prevalence of insomnia increased to nearly 18% from the 10% that we saw in the pre-COVID era. And second was the Ethiopian study, which also mentioned that there is an increase in the incidence of the in the prevalence of the insomnia during COVID time. But exact figure I'm not sure, but yes, there is an increase in the prevalence of the COVID, insomnia during COVID time.
Okay, thank you. That's excellent, actually, and the references that you provided. Dr. Suresh, do you have any comments or editorial on this question before I move on?
I think there is a lot of this insomnia, which is, I would just put it as it's more situational because of the presence of a lot of stress factors and having elderly people in your family, which also tends to put in a lot of stress in terms of in this COVID era. So that's what I would like to put that it's probably a situational stressor which is coming up, and it is not. It wouldn't really portray a true incidence of insomnia in COVID. It's probably situational because of the surrounding issues which are coming up with elderly people in the family, children in the family, loss of work, loss of income. So many things that are sort of comorbid conditions or comorbid situations are pulled in together to really account for an insomnia. So I wouldn't really put it as a pathological process which is causing it. It's probably situational, and it may disappear as the situation abates.
Yeah, that's excellent. So you all put...
Sorry to interrupt. So actually, I have something to... I have something to say here. I think regarding this insomnia thing, I would like to again classify it into two types. One is that there is... what I feel from my practice as well as from the current environment is that there is a change in the circadian pattern of people's mostly all over the country. There is a shifting of the bedtime towards the more late. And since a lot of things are being done online, including work from home, including school from home. So that is increasing the screen time drastically and hence the exposure to the various like 430 nanometer bluish light that we all know kind of wreaks havoc with our circadian pattern. So that is one very important area that we need to consider, that because of these high exposure to screen and this kind of light, our circadian patterns are getting disrupted, and actually a lot of what has been portrayed as insomnia is actually a delayed phase circadian rhythm disorder. That is one. And however, at the same time, there is actually an increased incidence of anxiety and depression in a large part of the population because of lack of jobs, lack of finances, high level of insecurity prevalent in the entire population. All these, along with these, like the true insomnia, that also I feel has the potential to increase in the current scenario. So that would be my submission, sir.
Thank you, Saurabh, for making my life easy, because I was just about to give those comments, especially in the lockdown. We have a very irregular lifestyle, and you very appropriately addressed the proper timing. So thank you so much for doing that. All right, the topic of the second question somebody has asked is about the disinfection of equipment, beds and such. So there was a very nice video. It was quite informational. During the faculty lecture also, this topic was addressed. I would like you to summarize this, and while you are at it, Dr. Saurabh, summarize it, this topic, plus add, and I'm asking other faculty as well to prepare your comments about the linen and the beds and the pillows and those kind of things. So we talk about equipment, but that's one thing, but also an average citizen would be concerned about coming into the lab and sleeping in a bed which could be infected. So go ahead,
So thank you for the opportunity. First, I'd like to mention here that in the current times, there is actually availability of disposable bed sheets in the market, which can be used by the sleep labs all over the country. And once we use disposable bed sheets for like doing the sleep tests in the labs, a lot of the problem gets solved because we don't have the problem of washing and cleaning all those things. However, in certain cases where we cannot access or we cannot get hands on those kinds of sheets. We can use the standard bed sheets, but they have to be like from after once the study is over, they have to be separated at the very beginning and put in a safety container from which they can be transported to the place of washing, where they should be washed with first with detergents and of course air dried, preferably in sunlight. Now, since we when we are conducting a study, we have to take every study as a potential way of spreading COVID infection, because we have to take into account the risk of the person who is washing the clothes as well as the risk of the person who is doing the study. So in thinking about their safety, we have to ensure like separation and proper washing and cleaning should be properly labeled that this has been this is different from the routine household clothing cleanings that we do. That is one part regarding the washing of the linens and other stuff. However, I would suggest that it is much preferable and much easier for the lab also to use disposable bed sheets for this for the current times. And they are available quite cheaply as well in India.
I like to add a counterpoint to that because it all comes with an added expense. So you have to really look at your books and how you are going to allocate the financing for your disposable materials. So there is always a little twist to the story.
Yes,
any other comments? Very, very nice comments. Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. Any other comments? I'm open right now for this question about the linen, beds, disinfection.
I just think one more thing. We talk about the disinfection linen. The ventilation, I feel, is also very important. As far as possible, open up as much as you can, put the exhausts on, open the doors, I mean, if possible. So that negative pressure areas or rooms, I think, are a hard finding in India. We're not going to have them available so easily. So we just need to at least make sure that there is good air circulation in addition to whatever else we do with social distancing.
I think what we have done in some of the rooms is that we reverse the fan. We have a table fan which comes or a pedestal fan. Just reverse the direction. So what it actually sucks out the air and pushes it out.
It's like a exhaust.
It's like an exhaust. Yes, exactly. So it works very well, and
so we need definitely an exhaust or keep things open so that especially in between two. It's been said that they should have many hours of free time of that lab. So one person going in, the next person coming in, especially there should be an interval for a few hours. I mean, it's not specific, but how long?
You know, if you take it from the hotel industry in United States, it's a 3 days, 72 hours. They will not allow another guest to check into the same room.
That's why those are closed maybe, but we hopefully we can, at least in India, we have more provision to keep things open wherever we do have. The central air conditioning is going to become a problem for such situations.
Yeah, any guidelines or any instructions cannot be universal in this setting. It depends on the local situations. So I just want to make sure that people understand this, turning the fan outwards. You have to make sure where the air is going to be released. So from the room, don't release it into the hallway and inside the building. It has to be released outside.
Not in the that window.
That's very important. But otherwise, you'll be actually facilitating the spread of the virus in case there is virus. Okay. I think next two questions, I'll put them together because they were part of the talk and Dr. Ravi has addressed them. And I would look up to Dr. Ravi for re-summarizing it. How to choose patient for PSG and HST, and you have done a great job. But maybe just summary for the person who has asked this question. And can we do a level one PSG? And I think that was also reviewed, but we can summarize it for the sake of completion before we go to next.
Thank you, sir. Sir, as of now, if we follow the guidelines, then probably we can choose the non-complicated patients with the USA who are having the high probability of having the positive test during the sleep apnea stream. So the probability of the positive test one can get from number of questionnaires like the Berlin questionnaire or Stop Bank questionnaire. They can go with the clinical examination. And if the probability is high, then probably one can go for the home sleep apnea testing. But of course, the question remains, what happens to the patients who are having the complicated cases along with the OSA? So that is again an area that I think we need to look into, and probably I could find some articles which mention that AutoPath can be used in the obesity hypovolemia syndrome. And if we go with those articles, because of course they were, I could find only one randomized control trial, which said that AutoPath can safely be used in obesity hypovolemia syndrome. So that also opens another era where we can go for the home sleep apnea testing in those cases who are having obesity hypoventilation. Coming to the level one, again, as Manvir ma'am has pointed out very clearly, that one has to choose the whether he wants to really do the level one study depending upon the patient's condition. And as mentioned in your talk as well, regarding the prevalence of the COVID in the community, as well as the health of the patients of being COVID positive. So I think those two all considerations should be taken into account before deciding whether one needs to go for the level one study.
Okay. Does ISSR provide any resource in case I'm a practitioner in the community and I don't know what to do? May I able to write an email and expect an answer?
Of course, sir. I think we are ready to answer. And of course, all the issues that we are discussing here are also mentioned in the guidelines, which are freely available on the website of the Sleep and Vigilance. So all the listeners, they can go to the website of the Sleep and Vigilance. They can download the guidelines and they can get all the things that we are discussing in the text form.
Thank you. And that's very important, because the guidelines are there. Once you read it, and they are very interesting, once you start reading them, you would like to finish them, because the material, the way it is presented, is so easy to understand, and you will be able to apply it in your practice very, very quickly. Thank you very much for that summary of the HST and PSG. One comment that I would like to make on that subject is that there are specific guidelines about the delivery and pickup of the home sleep testing equipment to the patient. Generally, what is advised is that don't bring the patient or their family members to the lab in order to pick up and return the device. Either use a third party intermediary agency like UPS or whatever the local courier service is, that by way of contract can provide. And again, there is a cost associated with it. And I keep bringing up the issue of the cost because that becomes prohibitive and a lot of people are unable to practice when you advise anything where there is additional cost. Also, the recommendations are that in case this has to happen, that there is no other way, you can deliver that home sleep testing machine at the curbside. So your employee goes outside with the proper gear, protective gear, and hands over the machine to the patient or their family, and same way they return it. When the machine is returned, you have to be very, very careful because it could be infected. And before you start downloading the data, et cetera, it should be disinfected. And then only you download the data. So those are some of the nuances of these guidelines are there that we did not have time to discuss. So thank you for that.
UV light sort of a screening or a UV light projection on the device, would it suffice to sort of sterilize? UVC lights are available. There are portable lights that are available which can be run on the CPAP machine.
Yeah, I don't think we have the answer to that. People are doing it for food, for various items, for phones, for stethoscopes when they're coming back. I guess I don't know if you believe in that it will work for this. It just depends if you think that those are the things which work.
Because I have been using a sterilizer for my knee hammers and stethoscopes, yeah, which we run it on for at least 5 minutes on the bed sheet itself, on the examining cot itself. So I feel that it may be good enough, but I don't have any proof to say that it's really.
I mean, I don't know. I think it's individual, but I just believe that we just clean it between each use with a isopropyl 80% alcohol, put it onto a swab, and just wipe everything down. Wipe the outside of the labs which come in. Wipe the devices, wipe all the cables and the sensors, and the complete electrodes have to be wiped.
some of the hospitals have UV light, and when physicians and other staff checks in, not only all the equipment that you mentioned and Dr. Suresh mentioned, they also have the reading glasses, sunglasses, cell phones, wallets, sterilized through that. But CTC does not have any position on that as of yet, or at least I do not know. So if somebody knows and if there are there's supporting literature, I'll be very happy to hear at this point from the faculty.
We don't have any specific literature, but there is one company in Bombay which is manufacturing this this equipment, which is actually about a foot long and about 3 inches sort of in size on the diameter part of it. And it's they recommend that this is screened over the equipment for about a period of 3 to 5 minutes, and depending on how much of sterility you want, the average distance should be maintained is about six centimeters to about maximum of 10 centimeters to get adequate UVC light protection. This has been discovered, done by scientists from the Atomic Research Center from Bombay. And I'll try to see if we can get you some more details on that and what is the data available on the sterility part of it.
I'm very interested because of my interest in sleep and vigilance, and all these things can make a very good article, which a lot of people would like to read. So thank you for bringing up those topics. The next question here is, and I have to keep up with the time here, because there is a number of questions and comments that will be coming up very soon. Interesting question, and I would like all of the faculty to consider that and make comments. Should PSG be allowed for the research during the pandemic? This came from the audience online while you were discussing your lectures. Everybody does research. Everybody is doing research, and you have grants sitting there. If you delay, you are going behind on your timeline in terms of the grant time. So money is involved, time is involved, your project is pending, and the pandemic is here. How would you like to answer that question?
So I would say whether it is for research or whether it is for clinical. So the criteria.
You are saying basic science research and clinical research. We are addressing research. Question is asking for allowed for research.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to say is if you're doing a level one study, for whatever the purpose, we have to follow the same principles. That's okay. What I feel. So if we are sure about the endemicity of, or the what category you're fitting into your COVID situation, if you are able to take care of completely all the things that we mentioned, the technical, the equipment, the facility, follows all the rules, then I guess so. But it would be for anything. I mean, as long as we fit all those requirements, do all the checklist function.
I tend to agree. I concur. I think once we're taking the responsibility to have the procedure, it's irrespective what is the outcome, whether it's going to patient care or research, which will ultimately reach patient care. I understand that there may be more of a financial drive, but being physicians, I don't think we get affected by financial drive and pressure. So if we're doing it because we think it's good for the patient in totality, so it would be the same.
So let's say you have an ICMR grant and they want the results by the end of September. Would you do it? And especially if you have a very high incidence of infection in your...
Then I wouldn't be optional studies either, then not. If you've opened the lab and you are, again, having the procedures done because your lab is in a relatively stratified area and you've taken the decision to have the studies. So also probably want to make sure the location of your research lab, is it in, where is it located? Is it in a standalone place or is it in a hospital which is catering to COVID patients, and there you may want to not restart sleep services.
So thank you. Saurav, I'm coming to you. So I really like your non-ambiguous, solid, confident, straightforward answers, because that really helps me and my audience. Dr. Saurav, you have come.
Yeah, sir, I would like to add a twist to this question actually. Now, suppose this research involves patients who do not have OSA necessarily, who like the researchers looking at other aspects of sleep and are testing non-OSA patients for like with the polysomnography, then does the answer to the question change?
Same. Because so you are still exposing your healthcare personnel, and who is a subject is also a patient, no? It's a living body. So that patient is a source. The healthcare personnel are at risk of transmission. The environment, like she mentioned, where is the research lab? It's in a hospital. Next door is the ward for COVID. So whether it is OSA, not OSA, you take a decision that should I abide by the same guidelines or not.
I would like to thank Dr. Saurav for bringing up a very, very important topic, because all these questions and these answers relate to one thing: what are the basic principles of practice of sleep medicine during the pandemic? And basic principles will not change once we have decided that how to protect our subject, research subjects, our researchers, our research assistant, lab technicians, or the researchers themselves. So that's a very, very good point. And thank you so much for that. So we'll follow the same guidelines. Dr. Just like
Malik wanted to say something.
Clinical patients. Yes, thank you.
Yeah, for research lab, we have to follow the government guidelines.
Yes, sir.
They were suspended. Now they have opened up, but you have to follow the government guidelines for research activities.
Yes, sir.
Period.
I have a question.
Thank you, Dr. Malik.
There is actually, when we use a humidifier, there's a lot of aerosol generation which occurs in that period of time. And is it a risk for the co-partner also to contract some sort of a problem? Though it's quite clear that the COVID can be transmitted to a household member, but anybody else who's around or somebody who's going to come to clean the place, would that aerosol have a problem which is there from the humidifier?
Dr. Suresh Kumar, you are asking aerosol will have a problem even if the patient is suspected of COVID?
Yeah, aerosol and the family members. If you, for example, the titration is going on and you have a family member who is also sitting out there. And
yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
This whole thing is about the aerosolization. So unfortunately, the family members or anybody else at risk should not be in that environment, or should have a PPE, for example, our technician.
Correct. But yeah. What about household members, for example, the spouses or some children who are there in the same room and they do not have a situation where they can afford to have single rooms for each of them? So
Some people are saying to remove the humidifier and use only the PAP, if possible.
That also, I think it was Dr. Abhishek or Dr. Saurav, one of them, mentioned about you need to talk to your physician in that setting, that depending on the severity of sleep apnea, what is at risk? Your health is at more risk versus your family's health is more at risk. And you have to decide whether you can discontinue until you recover from that infectious phase of the COVID. So the good points. Well, next question is, again, for all of the faculty, and I think Dr. Abhishek talked about, Dr. Saurav actually talked about the CPAP, so targeted to him. And this is from my good friend, Dr. Iyer. He has one question, but there are two parts to it. So we'll address one part at a time. So first part of the question is OSA patient more prone to COVID-19?
Sir, I think there is evidence building up, which is showing that actually the OSA patients are more prone to get a COVID-19 infected. The risk is basically at two levels. First is that the pathophysiology of OSA itself generates lots of free radicals and causes a immune storm in the body over a long period of time. And that kind of decreases the immunity and health, and hence makes the person susceptible to get infected with COVID-19. At the same point, there is another issue also involved, that is a lot of patients who have OSA have other comorbidities, including obesity, diabetes, hypertension, a lot of other stuff, which again, independent, each of these carries an independent risk factor for of infection with COVID-19. So I think the simple answer to this question is yes, a patient having OSA is definitely more at risk of getting COVID-19 infected than a person without OSA.
Okay. Other faculty? Senior faculty, all the faculty, panelists.
Sir, I would like to add something to that. So yes, all the human beings on this planet are now going to be affected with this virus. No one is going to be spared. But the people who are having OSA, they are likely to have more complications of COVID, like in form of ARDS and vasculopathy, because they are already at risk. So as far as infection is concerned, I don't think the OSA patients are more at risk. But the complications, yes, they should be.
I think there's a good article in the Journal of Clinical Sleep Medicine, a letter to the editor, which our delegates can refer to, where the complexity of the COVID infection was what is discussed. Don't think we have enough data to say the prevalence would be different, incidence would be different. So I can, you know, of course, this is evolving and it would be a good resource. So.
Dr. Ravi?
Okay.
Dr. Ravi, Sir, I go with what Abhishek and Pradeem has already told. I refer to the same article that the Pradeem is referring to. And it simply says that the patients are at more at risk of developing the complications. Yep. And not sure whether they are more at risk of getting the infection.
Okay. So thank you. Those are good comments. My bias is that clearly OSA comes with a lot of other baggage, other comorbid conditions, and those comorbid conditions are already established. For example, overweight, obesity, hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular complications. So OSA is a syndrome, as we know. So we can look at it as a syndrome and then see what makes it a syndrome and all those comorbid conditions. So clearly it will be someday proven, because we like to see evidence-based and randomized controlled and all those things, data to support it. And I'm sure that that will happen very soon. So as Dr. Sarov said, literature is building, so it is. The second part of this question is, does OSA impact the outcome of the COVID-19? Dr. Abhishek already said the complications, you confirmed that the complications are going to be more, whether it will impact the long-term morbidity or mortality. Could you please?
I would like to go for the answer first. I'm also working in COVID ICU simultaneously. So yes, we are seeing a lot of obese patients who are coming to our ICU as compared to the general lean, thin patients. And these patients usually require very high NIV pressures. So, and the outcome is definitely worse in these obese individuals compared to other patients who are less obese or less, they are younger. So since OSA is more prevalent in elderly, obese and male gender, so we are seeing that if patient is having OSA, his NIV requirement, his pressure requirement is definitely high, and the complication and outcome are definitely going to be worse as compared to other COVID ARDS patient who are leaner and are younger.
Thank you. Other comments on the outcomes of the COVID-19 in patients with OSA? So they have already a known case of OSA. They are on CPAP and they catch COVID. What your comments are? Dr. Ravi?
Sir, as of now, I did not come across any literature. And unfortunately, I'm not working with those kind of patients. So probably, I think you and Abhishek are the best persons to answer this question.
Okay. Yes, and he did very well. You know, there is big data now available. Just if you look at the prevalence of the obstructive sleep apnea, look at the how many people in every country are infected with COVID and they are going through this process, I think people are definitely looking at all these combinations, and hopefully we will learn in next many months about what exactly the truth is. But again, just like the first part of this question, Dr. Iyer, thank you for asking that, because this zooms us in and focuses into the what the COVID-19 is going to play out as in terms of the obstructive sleep apnea and its outcomes. So thank you for asking that question. We have discussed a number of case scenarios. I think I have no more questions. There is something is showing up here on the chat box. Okay, so Dr. Manveer, would you like to make comment on the data regarding the increased prescription of medications for sleep and anxiety implying that there is high level of anxiety in the population and they are seeking help.
This was, you know, when the insomnia question, I agree we do not have any much data about the increased prevalence, etc. But right in the beginning, about 2 months ago, when I started looking, there was data from US that there is increase in the number of prescriptions of antidepressants, anti-anxiety, and sedative hypnotics. So meaning or suggesting that sleep as an underlying issue was increasing frequently. So just to go over the same thing that I think in our personal practices, we've all seen that insomnia complaints have surged a lot.
Right.
That's all.
And this is all expected, but it's good to review these topics. Now, one of the things that we discussed, and this will be a comments for all of the faculty, is that what are the alternate treatments available, and what's their a real practical value, and whether they are also easily available if the patient is diagnosed with sleep apnea, with HST, or even with just the clinical diagnosis, you know, we are able to prescribe CPAP just with the clinical diagnosis. So history of the patient, high pretest probability. You don't have to do testing, go ahead and prescribe AutoPAP, and that is allowed and insurance companies are paying. So similarly, if a patient is unable to get CPAP for whatever reason, cannot use, one situation would be just like you brought up, that Dr. Suresh brought up, that if they are living in a situation where the family is exposed, they have only one room apartment, where everybody is living. What are some of the alternate treatments that you would suggest? Suggesting alternate treatments means dental appliances, hypoglossal nerve stimulation, some other surgical interventions. Comments, please. Dr. Manveer, you are on, so we can start with you. I see you on the screen.
So we have the other options available, I agree, but some of them are not available in our country. So firstly, okay, we do not have hypoglossal stimulation, etc. But yes, dental devices, and particularly, I think the same kind of principles would apply, whether we are in this situation or not, that the ones who are mild or mild to moderate. But then the other issue is there, that who are the dentists who are working nowadays? I have a few dental colleagues, and their practices are suffering even more than ours, because they've opened now a few hours in a day, and that's also not. So which are the people who are going to go there willingly, and repeated visits for a dental appliance, setting of the dental appliance, side effects to dental appliance?
Yes.
So I think it's not an easy answer. Maybe lifestyle measures and things would work, but it's you know, if possible, if you can get up, if they are severe, we should try and think about a PAP only.
Abhishek, did you raise your hand?
Yes, sir. Sir, are you talking about patient who is COVID positive?
No, just sleep apnea.
Sir, if we are talking that OSA will lead to more complication if the patient develops infection of COVID, and if presence of OSA leads to more complication in the form of ARDS or coagulopathy, then that patient should continue using CPAP, in my opinion. Otherwise, he is going to develop, if he is not using CPAP for a few days, again, he is going to develop the same inflammatory process, and he will be at risk for developing. The most simple question, solution will be, he should sleep in some other room where his family member cannot be there during whenever he is using CPAP. That is the best solution according to me.
Okay, thank you. The American Academy of Dental Sleep Medicine actually has guidelines. They are pretty much one-page guidelines, but nevertheless, they have issued guidelines very quickly, I think in March 2020, and they recommend use of oral appliances. As Dr. Manveer mentioned, that the oral appliances can take up to 3 months, 4 months before they can be fitted. There are temporary appliances available as opposed to permanent, and they can be fitted in somewhere between 15 minutes to a couple of days. These are boil and bite type appliances. And there is a very, very good review of 6 available appliances which are FDA approved in Sleep Review. So that is something to look at. And dentists here have not caught on this pandemic thing and are not doing anything significant in that regard. But clearly, since we are discussing it, and eventually, even if in India, we do not have as much dental appliance prevalence, but it is going to happen slowly but certainly, because that's one good way. It does not increase the compliance, but at least people are likely to use it a little more. That's what I would like to say. Hypoglossal nerve stimulator, same thing. The surgical, unless it's an emergency, it's not emergency procedure. It's indicated for mild to moderate sleep apnea, and you need the elective time in the OR, and nobody is doing elective surgery. So that also goes out of the door. Same thing applies for UPPP and other surgical interventions. So I just wanted to mention that there is a little science developing in the area of the dentistry, or the sleep dentistry, I should say. Okay. So thank you for that discussion. Dr. Manveer, you're trying to make a comment. I understand.
Okay. Timing, I was just saying, I think if the questions are done, we can maybe.
Almost there. That last thing I just acted up. I had a question for Abhishek, but he has already answered, so I don't think that we have to do. So thank you very much, all the faculty panelists, for answering all these wonderful questions. Some were very pointy, some had very straightforward, clear answers, which I truly appreciate, and some of them we really don't know at this point as of today's webinar. Comes next webinar, we may have some more answers and some more new questions that will come up. So with that, I'll conclude the question answer session. And thank you very much. Back to you, Vatsala.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Now I request Dr. Manveer Bhatia to give the conclusion remarks for the session.
Thank you, the faculty, the panelists, and Dr. Preeti, Dr. Deepak Dhawal, who took care of these important two summarizing all the discussions that we've had. I just want to conclude by saying that, so what did we really learn from all this? I think we've gone over the two major things are, what is the situation in the environment? It determines our status of opening up the labs, risks to the patient and risk to the staff. Unfortunately, we do the recommendations which are there for HST, things like disposable labs, we don't have, it's not easy to get them. It's for our cost effectiveness for our country. The negative pressure rooms are not going to be available. So I guess we will have to work on our own, make our own strategy, make our own policies, and make sure that we keep the patients safe, but continue to deliver healthcare and keep our staff safe. That's all that I can say. And I would like to now invite Dr. Kamlesh. She's the General Secretary of the Indian Society for Sleep Research and also working as a scientist at the Sichitra Institute in Trivandrum.
Very good evening, all participants. Thank you very much for your active participation. As this COVID-19 Unlock Sleep Services Dialogue webinar is very special and timely. I'm glad to share that all the delegates were connected tonight through this platform of Indian Society for Sleep Research, to which the technical support was provided by Philips. I thank Philips for providing seamless connectivity for this program. This event indeed is a testimony to the fact that the sleep practice is ready to rock again and to serve the people soon. Dear participant, thank you very much for your enthusiasm that has made this special webinar program a great success, a real historical event for the ISSR. Hats off to our eminent faculty and panelists who joined tonight from all over the globe during COVID-19 pandemic at a time when we have to follow the physical distancing. Thankfully, this perfect remote virtual meeting has become a new norm these days. Your vibrant sharing of new prevalent scientific knowledge and know-how has provided roadmap for starting the sleep practice with the safety of all. That's our motto. I express my deep gratitude to Dr. Mohan Kumar, who is the pioneer and father figure for Indian sleep research and medicine, for providing brilliant opening to the session tonight. Thank you, sir. I thank Dr. H.N. Malik, the president of ISSR, and the NSMC co-director for sharing overview of various activities of the ISSR and the sleep guidelines for the COVID-19 in the nutshell. Professor Deepak Srivastava, our true Kohinoor from California and also an SMC co-director. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your enriched US experience while dealing with the COVID-19 contagion, the brilliant handling of the question and answer session. Thank you very much, sir, for your precious time and commitment. I share that soon after this meeting, Deepak sir will be rushing to attend the ICU. That's how I've been told about it. Dr. Manveer Bhatia, the convener of this program, the vice president of ISSR, who is the backbone of this program, she's a real superstar for conceptualizing and realizing this program, which was a true challenge to address today. I thank you and your team, madam. I thank Dr. Preeti Devanani, who joined us today from Dubai, for brilliantly conducting the panel discussion. I thank Dr. Ravi Gupta, who joined us from AIIMS Rishikesh, for amazing updates. My special thanks goes to Dr. Suresh Kumar from Chennai, Dr. Saurav Das from Calcutta, Dr. Abhishek Goel from AIIMS Bhopal. It was truly wonderful to have your expert opinions. Thanks, Nidhi Bisht, for sharing virtual hands-on on disinfecting the sleep equipment. Once again, I thank Philips and their representative Sumit for providing the seamless digital framework tonight for such an important event. We look forward to continue this association in future as well. I once again thank all the participants, and I hope that the knowledge gained tonight will help you in carrying out the safe restarting of the sleep practices with utmost safety of the all. With these few words, I congratulate the entire team of ISSR, the panelists, dear participants, for making this program a big success. See you soon with yet another fruitful program on the ISSR platform. Good night and Jai Hind. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I just missed to say one more thing, that I would invite all delegates who are not yet members, please do become members for the Indian Society of Sleep Research. The website is issr.in. And we have 2-3 more interesting things planned for you in the near future, which would be virtual programs. One is a journal club, and second would be case presentations and discussions. If we have got all your emails, we will keep you updated about that, and look forward to seeing you all again soon in the near future. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good nights and good mornings to Dr. Deepak, has to go for work. Thank you, Vatsala, for putting together and being the backbone behind this. Thank you for all the effort.